Yeah, we were. Maria was the nearest larger city where we saw Jimmy Lou Harris. In Kentucky.
Maple Street Council.
I was ready with my cat-like reflexes, but you were even quicker.
Honestly, what I did was I put pixels with these little tiny elastics. And I tied my hair and did not pin it down. So what's gonna happen is I'm gonna have to undo it and then just undo the big knot.
I know you were.
It's shocking, amazing, it's a surprise.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Troy Street Coffee House. My name is John. We're hybrid again tonight, which means you could either be here like you are, you could be home in your pajamas watching via the camera that's on the ceiling here. The good news is tomorrow you could watch it all again because we archive all our performances. So if you want to hear it again, what can I say? We're a hardcore listening room. My regular bouncer, Jerry's not here tonight, but it won quite for me. And then somebody might find the hook someplace. So when the performers are performing, we're listening, as opposed to a bar where nobody cares. Been in operation for 53 years in this room. 53 years, 52 Fridays, it's about 2,800 people or performances. It's been quite the ride here. So tonight we've got Ed Ellis, who comes to us from LaGrange, a lifelong railroad man, he says. And there's flyers on the tables that'll give you some information about upcoming people who are going to be here yet. We are totally booked for 24 and have started doing bookings for 25. Turns out it's kind of an interesting place to play. Sometimes hard to get into. But at any rate, Ed, are you ready? Okay. Take your train and do your thing.
John said, I'm Ed Ellis, and I'm a railroad man. Many songwriters write songs about trains. Sometimes their lyrics have caused me great pains. Seems that the only train they'll ever see is one running around under a Christmas tree. But I've driven spikes, I've shoveled coal, stood by the track, watched the high cars roll, worked under engines with grease on my hands, ridden on freight trains all over this land. And I know the trains, Lord, I know the trains. I've switched those cars in the pouring down rain. I pulled the throttle, I've walked the main, I rode them everywhere, I know the trains. The line where I work could use some repairs. Let's find some songwriters, send them out there. Work on the track, they'll sweat and they'll strain. Then if they want, they can sing of a train. But I know the trains, Lord, I know the trains. I've switched those cars in pouring down rains. I pulled the throttle, I walked the mains. I rode them everywhere, I know the trains. If you have not ever ridden on a train, but you think you have a song on your brain, sing about cowboys or old Tennessee. Leave all the train songs for people like me. 'Cause I know the trains, Lord, I know the trains. I've switched those cars in the pouring down rains. I pulled the throttle, I walked the mains. I rode them everywhere, I know the trains. I rode them everywhere, I know that I've been working on the railroad all the live long day. I've been working on the railroad just to pass the time away. Can't you hear the whistle blow and rise up so early in the morn? Don't you hear the captain shouting, Dinah, blow your horn? Dinah, won't you blow? Dinah, won't you blow? Dinah, won't you blow your horn? Dinah, won't you blow? Dinah, won't you blow? Dinah, won't you blow your horn? Well, someone's in the kitchen with Dinah. Someone's in the kitchen, I know. Someone's in the kitchen with Dinah, strumming on the old banjo and singing fee, fi, fiddly, I, oh. Fee, fi, fiddly, I, oh, 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 oh. Fee, fi, fiddly, I, oh, strumming on the old banjo. Now you may think that's all of this song, and you're right. Thank you. So I grew up in Paducah, Kentucky, and I was interested in trains from the time I was very small. My mom and dad recognized this, and you know, they bought me trains, they took me down to see the train, we went to ride on trains. And my mom and dad liked trains too. My mom wouldn't fly, and my dad had a lot of experience with trains. Actually, he was in World War II, and after he got out, came to Chicago, and then got an invitation to go visit my mom, they weren't married yet, down in Mississippi. And so he went down to Central Station here in Chicago and got on the train overnight. And when he got ready to go to bed in the Pullman car in the berth, he said to the porter, I've not had a lot of sleep for the last 3 years, and it's probably going to be hard for me to wake up when we get to Grenada, Mississippi. So whatever happens, I'm going to resist it, but whatever happens, you got to wake me up. So the next morning, he actually wakes up on his own. He looks out the window, and gone by Grenada, they're coming into Winona, Mississippi. And oh my gosh, well, he grabs his sea bag, he jumps off the train, and he grabs a hold of porter and, you know, just gives him a long list of those really fine words that he learned in the Navy. And as he's walking away, he hears the conductor say to the porter, boy, that guy was mad at you. And he said, yeah, you should have seen the guy I put off in Grenada. Now, that's an apocryphal story, right? You could tell that story. I think I heard my dad tell it, and my mom confirmed that he actually hitchhiked all the way back to Grenada. But I heard somebody tell it with Washington to Knoxville, and I heard somebody tell it with Chicago to Minneapolis, and I actually was in England, and I heard somebody tell it from London to Plymouth to Penzance. So, you know, you can take that with you and do your own. But he told another story that she didn't really like, which meant that it was probably true. And he was, after the Navy and after he got down to Grenada, he became a salesman for General Foods, Maxwell House Coffee. And they invited him to a sales meeting in Chicago. So he got on the train, and he had a lower berth. And now, I got to stop here because I've just used the term lower berth. Does anybody know what a lower berth is? These are my people. They're old enough to know what a lower berth is. But for those of you who are under that age, you know, the Pullman Company was the way everybody traveled in this country for a long, long time, for almost 100 years. And there was even the lower berth was the standard accommodation. The upper berth was a little bit less than standard. But all that separated you from the aisle was a green curtain. And so you had a bed, and the porter pulled the curtain. You could zip it shut, sometimes button it shut, but that was it. And there was even a vaudeville routine about the birth. You could, the guy goes into the ticket office, and he asks the ticket agent, can I get a Pullman accommodation? And he says, sure, what do you want, a lower berth or an upper berth? And he says, well, which is better? Well, the lower berth is higher because it's lower. The upper is lower because it's higher. So if you want to go lower, take the upper. If you want to go higher, take the lower. It's about 25 cents difference. And they could go on with that for a while. So my dad was in the lower berth, and train pulls out. And a few minutes later, this young lady jumps into the berth and snuggles right up to him and says, boy, it's cold out there. We'll have to cuddle up like two spoons, sis. So he turns around and claps his hand over her mouth and says, lady, you're in the wrong bed. So she slinks away, goes back to her bed. The next morning, leaving Kankakee, he's sitting in the dining car, and she walks in. And she's looking around at all the businessmen sitting there in the dining car trying to figure out which one she jumped into bed with. And my dad holds up two spoons. So my mom did not like that. You know, if you're interested in Pullman, there's a really nice national park museum down by the town of Pullman. And, you know, Pullman, the Pullman car was invented by George Pullman, who was kind of a controversial character in the late 19th century. But you know what? Pullman had 100,000 beds every night in the 1920s. It was the largest hotel chain in the world. And the guy who did that was not George Pullman, because he was gone. It was the second president of Pullman who, you know, kind of like a modern businessman, bought up all the competition, made it a national brand. And that guy, the second president of Pullman, was Robert Todd Lincoln, the son of Abraham Lincoln. And he almost didn't get there because, and this is a true story, this is not apocryphal, you can look this up. And during the Civil War in 1864, Robert Todd Lincoln was on his way back from Harvard to Washington around what we now call Thanksgiving, and he was standing on a train platform in Newark, New Jersey, and as a train came in, somebody bumped him, and he fell in front of the train. And a hand reached down and grabbed him by the collar and pulled him to safety. And the man who saved the life of Abraham Lincoln's son was Edwin Booth, the brother of John Wilkes Booth. True story, true story. And so stories make me think of Larry Penn. Did anybody here get to hear Larry Penn play live? Larry Penn was a truck driver from Milwaukee who liked trains as much as me. And he traveled all around the Midwest, and he played in a lot of different places, and he had some good train stories. But one thing that happened to him, he was playing in Prairie du Chien, Wisconsin, and a guy came up to him with a piece of sheet metal. He said, Larry, this fell off of a Burlington Zephyr. I thought you might want to have it. And so this is Downers Grove, right? We all know what the Burlington is, right? Over here, that's the train that we take to Chicago. It's called the BNSF now, but was the Burlington Northern, and before that, it was the Burlington. And what did we call it back then? We called it the Q, because it was the Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy. And so anybody in the suburbs, which train do you take to work? I take the Q, or I take the Dinky, but that's a different story. But you take the Q. So Larry decided he needed to take this piece of sheet metal and write a song about it. It ended up not being in the song, but he got all kinds of other things, steam locomotives, the grab iron on the side of the boxcar, James J. Hill, who was the empire builder who built the Great Northern, and he also got milepost 14, which is in my backyard. So this is called Little Piece of the Cube. There's a Hudson locomotive in La Crosse and Coleman Park, given to the city when steam's last days were through. This Burlington 4000 sits in state for all to view, and the Coulee region's proud to have its little piece of the queue. Just a little piece of the queue, little piece of the queue. I don't want to own it all, I'm saving some for you. Just a little piece of the queue, just a little piece of the queue. When I die, you guys can have my little piece of the queue. A hobo caught the westbound on a dark and rainy night. He picked out a boxcar on the Burlington route. But as he climbed aboard, he felt the grab iron break in two. In his hands, he held on tight to a little piece of the queue. Just a little piece of the queue. Just a little piece of the queue. I don't want to own it all, I'm saving some for you. Just a little piece of the queue. Just a little piece of the queue. When I die, you guys can have my little piece of the queue. Milepost number 14 was replaced by something new. It was left there in the ditch by some uncaring crew. But saints preserved the history, come hernia or jail. And in the backyard now there stands a little piece of the queue. Just a little piece of the queue. A little piece of the queue. I don't want to own it all, I'm saving some for you. Just a little piece of the queue. Just a little piece of the queue. When I die, you guys can have my little piece of the queue. Now Jim Hill liked the northern route from St. Paul to the coast. Built himself an empire like those railroad barons do. But when he saw Chicago was a railroad town, he knew somehow he would have to own a little piece of the queue. Just a little piece of the queue. Just a little piece of the queue. I don't want to own it all, I'm saving some for you. Just a little piece of the queue. Just a little piece of the queue. When I die, you guys can have my little piece of the queue. When I die, you guys can have my little piece of the queue. Thank you. My wife would love it if you would come get my little piece of the queue. It's about a 400-pound concrete mile marker that they replaced with a tin metal thing a few years ago, and some friends and I really did get it to the backyard. I got the post hole digger out, dug a big hole, dropped it down in there. She came home and said, "What is that?" I said, "It's milepost 14." And she said, "What's it doing in the backyard?" I said, "It's resting. It's got to go." I said, I barely got it in there. I just don't think I can get it out. And it is still there. So Larry was in a group with some other similarly interesting guys who were a combination of, labor union rabble-rousers and raconteurs, railroaders, musicians. It included Mark Ross, Cuddy, Utah Phillips, and they called themselves the Rose Tattoo. And because they called themselves the Rose Tattoo, they decided that everybody had to have a Rose Tattoo. So everybody got a Rose Tattoo, some of which could be seen and others of which were not in places that could be seen. So that meant that Larry had to also write a song called the Rose Tattoo. She had a rose tattoo. You know I have one too. I'm going to start that over. She had a rose tattoo. You know I have one too. And I asked her, was it there for someone she once knew? Maybe it is, she said. And maybe not, she said. It's just a rose. It's just a rose. She may have done some time. You know I've done time too. So I asked her, was it there for something wrong to do? Maybe it is, she said. Maybe not, she said. It's just a rose. It's just a rose. It's just a rose, she said. Nothing more or less. something that you get. It's just a rose. It's just a rose, she said. And that was all she said. It's just a rose. It's just a rose. She had to go somewhere. I had to leave there too. So I asked her, was there somewhere I could take her to? Maybe there is, she said. But maybe not, she said. It's just a rose. It's just a rose. She never said goodbye. You know, I don't know why. So I asked her, was there something I done that made her cry? Maybe there is, she said. But maybe not, she said. It's just a rose. It's just a rose. It's just a rose, she said. Nothing more or less. Something that you get. It's just a rose. It's just a rose, she said. And that was all she said. It's just a rose. It's just a rose. She had a rose tattoo. You know I have one too. So I asked her, was it there for someone she wants new? Maybe it is, she said. Maybe not, she said. It's just a rose. It's just a rose. It's just a rose. It's just a rose. Thank you. So Utah Phillips, who was in that group, was a guy who did a lot of things. He was a labor organizer. He was a member of the Wobblies, International Workers of the World, which was a pretty far-left union. And he was also a hobo. He rode trains all around the country in the late 40s and early 50s, something that I would not recommend. It's not a safe thing to do. He rode... Mark Ross, who was also in that group, was actually in a freight train derailment and, you know, lived to tell about it, but with injuries. But Utah was was somebody who not only rode the trains, but was really listening to what was going on in the country at the time. And he had a beautiful way of saying things. And so in this song, which is called Remember Loving You, he has this great phrase. I mean, if you think about Downers Grove here, it's a small town along a main line. And, I mean, you wouldn't necessarily describe it that way, but it is a small town, and there's a main line railroad right out here. Utah describes riding the train and says, the dumpy little towns along the stem is his way of saying a small town along a main line. So, really interesting phrasing from Utah. I look at my brown suitcase and I think of all the places that I've been. Railroad yards and the prison guards, dumpy little towns along the stem. And the whispering of the people as they watch every move I go through. I remember all these things, mostly I remember loving. I remember loving you back when the world was new. Think you love me too. I remember loving you. The buckskin smells, so the people tell, as we huddled in the boxcar from the rain. Flashing lights to cut the night, the railroad bulls that pulled us off the train. When the norther blows and the winter's cold, and I'm standing in a corner till I'm blue. I remember all these things, and mostly I remember loving you. I remember loving you back when the world was new. Think you love me too. remember loving you. The winter streets and the frozen sleet come soaking through the cardboard in my shoes. Promised land might be a place man can find free cigarettes and booze. And the alleyways full of ragged strays, the doorway wine I tell my troubles to. I remember all these things, but mostly I remember loving you. I remember loving you back when the world was new. Think you love me too? I remember loving you. I remember loving you back when the world was new. Think you love me too? I remember loving you. This next song, which is also from Utah and is also about life on the road, he always opened this song with a quote from Thomas Wolfe. If you don't know Thomas Wolfe, he was a writer from the 20s and 30s. You Can't Go Home Again, Look Homeward Angel were two of his books from Asheville, North Carolina. But he spent a lot of the 30s in Europe, because he was very popular there. He was in England and Germany and all over Western Europe. And when he was getting ready to come home, he wrote an essay about missing America. And this is what Utah always opened Starlight on the Rails with. We walked along a road in Cumberland and stooped because the sky hung down so low. And when we ran away from London, we went by little rivers in a land just big enough. And nowhere that we went was far. The earth and the sky were close and near. And the old hunger returned, the terrible and obscure hunger that haunts and hurts Americans and makes us exiles at home and strangers wherever we go. Oh, I will go up and down the country and back and forth across the country. I will go out west where the states are square. I will go to Boise and Helena, Albuquerque and the two Dakotas and all the unknown places. Say, brother, have you heard the roar of the fast express? Have you seen starlight on the rails?
I can hear the whistle calling. I am lonesome as can be. Outside, the rain is softly falling. Tonight, it's falling just for me. Looking back along the road I've traveled, all the miles could tell a million tales. Each year is like some rolling freight train, cold as starlight on the rails. I think about a wife and family, a home and all the things that means. The black smoke trailing out behind me, well, it's like a string of broken dreams. Looking back along the road I've traveled, all the miles could tell a million tales. Each year is like some rolling freight train, cold as starlight on the rails. A man who lives out on the highway, well, he's like a clock that can't tell time. A man who lives a life just rambling, he's like a song without a rhyme. Looking back along the road I've traveled, all the miles could tell a million tales. Each year is like some rolling freight train, cold as starlight on the rails.
It's cold as starlight on the rails. Cold as starlight on the rails.
Thank you. So Peggy and I moved to San Antonio as part of my railroad career, and at the time she was pregnant with our second child, we were looking for folk music, right? Because what else do you do on Friday night but go looking for live music somewhere? We loved San Antonio. The Kerrville Folk Festival is nearby, but it was fall, and we were looking for something. And of course, this was in 1993 or four. And how did you look back then? Well, I actually had to look in the newspaper. There wasn't any way to look it up online and see what was going on. So I got the San Antonio paper, and I looked for live music. I looked for something that sounded like folk music. And so there was a place called the Cibolo Creek Country Club that sounded pretty good. And they had this group called Trout Fishing in America. Has anybody heard of them? They're from Arkansas, and they're nice guys, good musicians. So I said, "What do you think?" And she said, "I don't know. I'm pregnant. I don't want to get dressed up." So I called them. I said, "Hey, we're interested in coming to this concert. What's the dress code?" And like, "Oh, come as you are. It's fine." So we get in the car, and this is also before Garmin, right? So we have a map, and we go this way and this way, and we go out this road, and we're driving down the road where the place is supposed to be, and there's a house over here, and there's a gas station, and there's a, you know, roadhouse. The technical term in Texas is a shit kicker bar over there, and we're not finding it. So finally I thought, okay, I got to ask. So I go into the bar, and I go, you know, and it's really a classic. It's got dollar bills stapled to the ceiling and peanut shells on the floor. I mean, it's, you can picture this. And I said, "We're looking for the Cibolo Creek Country Club." And they go, "You found it." And it turned out really to be quite a nice place, and we went back several times. And so one time when we went back, there was a woman from Dallas who was a singer-songwriter, and she had this song about the demise of trains, and she introduced it by saying, you know, it's such a shame that there really aren't any trains anymore. And I must have misunderstood this. So when got to the break, I went up and said, "Hi, I'm curious about your train song. You don't think there's trains anymore?" She said, "Yeah, I saw it on TV. You know, there aren't any trains anymore. There's some tracks out in front of my house, but I never see a train there." And I said, "Well, I work for the railroad." And she said, "Really? What do you do?" I said, "Well, I run trains." And so the more I thought about this, the more I thought, well, and she had seen a show on PBS about construction of railroads, and the fact that the narrator apparently spent some time, because I saw the show later, on the demise of the steam locomotive. And really, steam locomotives were pretty much gone in the late 50s, early 60s. And so there have been a lot of shows about, you know, what was steam like. And I think she probably just sort of took that and extrapolated, because there's no steam engines, there's no trains. So I had to cover this particular topic. She was watching a show on public TV about the opening of the West, how the railroad men with their hammers of steel blazed a trail for the rest. The narrator said, "Oh, what a shame that the sounds of steam are heard no more." It made her think as she grabbed her guitar and went on her way out the door. "I should have taken the train. I didn't know it was going away. If only I had opened my eyes or heard what the train had to say." She was on her way to a folk music club where she was about to sing and play. She thought about the trains and the fact that they had died. She might write a song today. It seemed odd to her as she came up to the track that the red flashing lights were on. A ghost from the past, an echo through the years. Too bad all the trains are gone. I should have taken the train. I didn't know they were going away. If only I had opened my eyes or heard what the train had to say. As she sped up on the tracks, she looked to the left. A bright headlight she saw. Four screaming diesels on 10,000 tons of coal, doing 60 miles an hour. The last thing she saw from the middle of the track, as the train down on her board, was a plate on the front of the lead locomotive. It said built in 2024. I should have taken the train. I didn't know I was getting in the way. If only I had opened my eyes or heard what the train had to say. I should have taken the train. If only I had opened my eyes or heard what the train had to say. Thank you. So a friend of my dad's, Roy Stewart, came over to the house one day. He knew I was interested in trains, and he said, hey, how'd you like to have my uniforms? Because he worked for the Illinois Central, and he was a passenger train conductor, flagman, brakeman, baggage man, all of the above. And I said, Mr. Stewart, don't you need your uniforms? He said, nope, I got fired. So, what happened? Well, it turned out he was supposed to work on a train called the Southern Express, which went from Chicago to New Orleans, but it was anything but an express. It was really the local mail train. It carried mail, it carried Railway Express Agency cars and baggage, and it only had one coach for passengers. And it was the slowest train on the railroad. It took 24 hours to go from Chicago to New Orleans, and city of New Orleans only took 16. So he was supposed to get on in Cairo and go south, and he got on. And when you leave North Cairo, you make a big left and go across the Ohio River, beautiful big bridge, and then you make a right and you stop in a few minutes in Wickliffe, Kentucky. And he knew that there was no baggage in Wickliffe because they didn't handle baggage there. So he was walking through the one coach helping the conductor collect tickets. And when they stopped in Wickliffe, he just pulled on the communication line so the engineer would get going. Well, while they didn't do baggage in Wickliffe, one thing they did do was human remains. And there was a casket in the baggage car. And the lady's relatives were all standing there at Wycliffe, and the hearse was standing there at Wycliffe. So when Roy got to Fulton, the train master, Carlos Collier, came out and said, Roy, how you doing? Roy said, good, how are you? Roy, you're fired. So I ended up with Roy's uniform. And this next song is not actually about Roy or the mail train, but it's sort of related in a way. They all said Louise was not half bad. It was written on the walls and window shades. Sometimes she'd act the little girl. A deceiver, don't believe her, that's her trade. Sometimes a bottle of perfume, flowers, and maybe some lace. Men brought Louise 10-cent trinkets. Their intentions were easily traced. And everybody knew at times she cried. Ah, but women like Louise, they get by. And everybody thought it kind of sad when they found Louise in her room. Though they put her down below their kind, still some cried when she died that afternoon. Louise rode home on the mail train somewhere to the south, I heard them say. Too bad it ended so ugly. Too bad she had to go this way. And the wind is blowing cold tonight. So good night. South, I heard them say, too bad it ended so ugly, too bad she had to go this away. And the wind is blowing cold tonight, so good night, Louise, good night. Good night, Louise. Good night. Thank you. Not all of the good lyrics actually have music, right? Some lyrics, you just say them without any music, and that, I think, is called poetry, probably. And one of my favorite railroad poems was written by Edna St. Vincent Millay, who was probably one of the most celebrated poets of the early 20th century, and it's called Travel. It's very short. The railroad track is miles away. The day is loud with voices speaking. Yet there isn't a train goes by day, but I hear its whistle shrieking. All night there isn't a train goes by, though the night is filled with sleep and dreaming, but I see its cinders red on the sky and hear its engine steaming. My heart is warm with the friends I make, and better friends I'll not be knowing. Yet there isn't a train I wouldn't take, no matter where it's going. And that's me. And actually, you know, it's interesting that in that particular poem, I see it as a very warm, inviting, you know, thing about travel. I recited it for a friend of mine several years ago, and he said, "Oh my God, that is a dark, angry poem." And I was like, How could that possibly be? So, well, whistle shrieking, red cinders on the sky, and wait a minute, you got all these great friends, and the first thing you're going to do is get on a train and go away? What's they're really probably not friends that are not that great. So it's all a matter of interpretation. So I'm going to close this set with another poem from Millay. She won the 1923 Pulitzer Prize with this poem, and it's been done by a lot of amazing people. It was actually a hit for Johnny Cash, of all people. It's not something you would think of Johnny Cash doing, but it's called Harp Weaver. "Son," said my mother when I was knee-high, "you've need of clothes to cover you, and not a rag have I. There's nothing in this house to make a boy breeches, nor shears to cut cloth with, nor thread to take stitches. There's nothing in this house but a loaf end of rye and a harp with a woman's head nobody will buy. and she began to cry. That was in the early fall. When came the late fall, "Son," she said, "the sight of you makes your mother's blood crawl. Little skinny shoulder blades sticking through your clothes, and where you'll get a jacket from, God above knows. It's lucky for me, lad, your daddy's in the ground and can't see the way I let his son go around." And she made a queer sound. That was in the late fall. When the winter came, I'd not a pair of breeches nor a shirt to my name. I couldn't go to school or out of doors to play, and all the other little boys passed their way. "Son," said my mother, "come, climb into my lap, and I'll chafe your little bones while you take a nap." And oh, but we were silly for half an hour or more. Me with my long legs dragging on the floor, rock, rock, rocking to a Mother Goose rhyme. Oh, but we were happy for half an hour's time. But there was I, a great boy. And what would folks say to hear my mother singing me to sleep all day in such a daft way? Men say the winter was bad that year. Fuel was scarce and food was dear. A wind with a wolf's head howled about our door. And we burned up the chairs and sat upon the floor. All that was left us was a chair we couldn't break, and the harp with the woman's head nobody would take for song or pity's sake. The night before Christmas, I cried with a cold. I cried myself to sleep like a two-year-old. And in the deep night, I felt my mother rise and stare down upon me with love in her eyes. I saw my mother sitting in the one good chair, a light falling on her from I couldn't tell where, looking 19 and not a day older, and the harp with the woman's head leaned against her shoulder, her thin fingers moving, and the thin, tall strings were weaving wonderful things. Many bright threads from where I couldn't see were running through the harp strings rapidly, and gold threads whistling through my mother's hands. I saw the web grow, the pattern expand. She wove a child's jacket, and when it was done, she laid it on the floor and wove another one. She wove a red cloak so regal to see. "She's made it for a king's son," I said, "not for me," but I knew it was for me. She wove a pair of breeches quicker than that. She wove a pair of boots and a little cocked hat. She wove a pair of mittens. She wove a little blouse. She wove all night in the still, cold house. She sang as she worked, and the harp strings spoke. Her voice never faltered. The thread never broke. And when I awoke, there sat my mother with the harp against her shoulder, looking 19 and not a day older, a smile about her lips and a light about her head, and her hands in the harp strings, frozen dead. And piled up beside her, toppling to the skies, were the clothes of a king's son, just my size. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to take a short break. Washrooms out the door and to your left. If you go to the right, you'll be going back outside. People have asked me about this. I have to, every so often I have to admit, the reason why I wear a hat, shield your eyes, because the chrome on my dome there is getting further back, and I wouldn't want to blind anybody. So take a short break, and we'll be back shortly.
know, when you're here, when you were here, I wasn't here. So somebody will teach me how to make $1 billion.
A billion?
A billion.
It's way too many.
Why?
A billion? Who needs that much money?
That's a lot of dollars.
What would you do with it?
Yeah, 5 billion's enough.
I wouldn't know where to spend it.
You're going to have five billion, not 5 billion.
That's right. You know,
the taxes and inflation, they just need to grow. Let's get real here.
I speared it with my walking stick. Ooh, like washing stick. Oh, yes, it's
large fish.
It's 30 inches long.
Oh, God.
It was a lake trout. Who wants to see?
Oh, come on, you had to shoot it with like a 30-06.
Oh, wow.
How much did that thing weigh?
It weighed a lot.
So where was this?
Oh, my God, Bobby, you got to see
this fish. In your Trevor City 2 weeks ago. And I speared it with my walking stick. It was sick. And he was swimming by the shore.
Nice fish here.
And, that's a lake trout. You're in Lake Michigan. Oh, and I caught it with my walking stick. I speared it. He was dying. So it was by the shore. It was a female, actually, because my brother was there.
I tried to fall in.
This is why we have to
go on Dover Girls
to
see. I created a jewel.
Oh, yeah. I forgot that they're not like keeping me. I'm not Avril. Yeah, there's not that many. Also, I do have.
Oh, you can, yeah. So I did. So I take it if you got stuck going with the rumor and then added tissue.
Well, no, they're adding.
Yeah, but you're nuts.
How's it going? Yeah. What are you doing? I can't make any of this. It's always like in a car. Yeah.
Coffee, I don't know what you're doing.
You play at the.
Yeah, me too.
Okay. I'm sorry. I'll talk. I'll see you.
Hey, see you guys.
Okay, whoa, Randy, turn that baby up. So for those of you who are here, we're going to have a second set. Hear more about trains. Next Friday, the 16th, we have a guy named Sam Robbins who's coming up from Nashville. He's, I think Sam's been here before. Oh, that's right. He was supposed to, and then something happened. All right, so it'll be Sam's first time here. Tomorrow, that's tomorrow, 7 p.m., Stone and Snow, yeah, over at the Maple Street Chapel in Lombard, the historic Maple Street Chapel that has no indoor plumbing. You have to go next door. This Tuesday, a few days from now, we'll be having our BYOS in this room, Bring Your Own Song. That starts from 7 to 9. There's a volunteer who leads that. You can bring a song, either something you wrote, something you're working on, or just want to listen to other people's songs. And yeah. So with all of that, where did he go? You, oh, there he is. Yikes, he was hiding. Let's welcome back Ed.
Hey, mister, could you use an old folk singer? Would your patrons like some old-time soul? Can they dig the foggy mountain breakdown? Mister, I don't play no rock and roll. I can make them cry to Molly, darling. Sing along the row your boat ashore. I'll play until the dawn when the crowd is gone. Mister, I'll be glad to sweep your floor. You should have been in New York back in 60. Wasn't I a star there for a while? But New York messed up my head. I couldn't make much bread. Little Bobby Dylan cramped my style. But I can make 'em cry to Molly, darling. sing along to row your boat ashore. Street life sure is fun when you're 21. Mister, I ain't 21 no more. So I take the love of them who still remember. I take the help of them who care to give. I swap my songs for sandwiches and shelter. Even a living legend's gotta live. But I can make 'em cry to Molly, darling. Sing along to row your boat ashore. Michael, row your boat ashore. Alleluia. You know this. Michael, row your boat ashore. Alleluia. Sister, set and trim the sails. Alleluia. Sister, set and trim the sails. Alleluia. The River Jordan is chilly and cold. Alleluia. Chills the body but not the soul. Alleluia. And Michael, row your boat ashore. Alleluia. Michael, row your boat ashore. Hallelujah.
That song was written by Shel Silverstein. Shel was a fixture in the 60s. He wrote books. He was a columnist for Playboy magazine, and he wrote a bunch of songs. He wrote A Boy Named Sue that was a hit for Johnny Cash, 25 Minutes to Go, The Unicorn Song. And he and Steve Goodman did a song, which you may or may not remember. I went to sleep last night with my TV on. Oh, what a dream I had. I dreamed I went and answered every single one, those late night mail order ads. 4 to 6 weeks later, much to my surprise, the mailman came to my front door, couldn't believe my eyes. When he brought the Vegematic, the Pocket Fisherman too, illuminated, illustrated history of life, Boxcar Willie with a Ginzu knife, the bamboo steamer, smokeless ashtray too, and a tie-dyed day glow souvenir shirt from Six Flags over Burbank. Well, the doorbell rang all morning, rang all afternoon. It kept on ringing all night long to the light of the MasterCard moon. There was COD to the ceiling, UPS in the hall. There was parcel post in the pantry. I just couldn't pay for it all. I got the egg scrambler with the seal-a-meal carry-in case. Set a presidential commemorative plate so I could eat my eggs off the president's face. A minute mender. Needle that or knit or crochet, and an autographed photograph of Ren 10-10 from Six Flags over Burbank. Well, I remembered I was dreaming, gave a mighty cheer. When I awoke, was no joke, all that junk was here. So if you fall asleep with your TV on, let me tell you what you do. You rip that telephone out of the wall unless you want it to happen to you. You'll get the D-Day video, the veteran's cheap term life, a 900 number to get you a lover any shape, any size, just for you.
the bamboo steamer, and the garden weasel too, and an all-expenses-paid weekend for three from Six Flags over Burbank. You can tell that song's dated. Ripped a telephone out of the wall, right? I think we probably all ripped them out of the wall a while ago. So that was by Shell and Steve. And then probably, you know, this is short, but one of the first Shell Silverstein songs I ever learned was one of the first songs I learned on the guitar. And the Smothers Brothers, I saw recently Tommy Smothers, Dick Smothers passed away, and Tommy Smothers said, yeah, this is one of our favorite songs to do. The slither, get the right key here, this. Slithery D came out of the sea. He got everybody, but he didn't get me. Ha, I got away. The slithery D came out of the sea. He got everybody, but he didn't get me. Stupid fish. The slithery D came out of the sea. He got everybody, but... Okay, it was probably funnier in 1966. Oh, no. I could hear it pretty good, too.
Yeah, he was picking up some
vocals. Okay, that's good. So, you know, time is something that we kind of take for granted in a way, right? You can look at your watch and you know that this clock on the wall says 10 minutes after 9. Your watch probably says something very close to 10 minutes after 9. Somebody's watch in Chicago says 10 minutes after 9. If they're in Burlington, Iowa, it's 10 minutes after 9. If they're in Omaha, Nebraska, it's still 10 minutes after 9. But if you go back to the 1870s, that was not the case. Everybody had their own local time. So if it was 10 minutes after 9 in Chicago, it might be 7 minutes after 9 in Downers Grove and 8:45 in Omaha. You know, the time was based on when the sun came up and went down, not based on anything scientific. And that was a problem for railroads because everybody needed to know when to go into the siding, and it needed to be at 9:07. It didn't need to be at 9:07 in Omaha. It needed to be 9:07 wherever the train was. So the railroads got together in Chicago in 1880 and created time zones. That's where time zones came from. And so anything in the central time zone had the same time, and that meant that when the dispatcher told the train to go in the siding and they went in at 9:10, they knew that it was 9:10 everywhere in the central time zone. And that was really important for safety. Of course, now, you know, there are still variations. I was listening to the tower at Union Avenue where the trains turned to go into Union Station the other day, and engineer called him and said, what time is it? And the tower operator said, well, it depends on which railroad you are. And he said, what do you mean? He said, well, if you're Burlington Northern Santa Fe, it's 2:10 p.m. If you're Canadian National, it's 14:10. If you're Metra, Mickey's Big Hand is on the 12. And if you're Amtrak, it's Friday. So time is important. And if you think about clocks in the mid-19th century, there was a guy who wrote a song about a clock. His name was Henry Clay Work. Has anybody heard that name? This is a relatively new name to me. Henry Clay Work was the most popular songwriter of the mid-19th century. Now, how would you know that somebody was a popular songwriter? I mean, they weren't on Spotify, right? They didn't have a million albums or EPs or whatever, CDs, none of that. How you knew they were a popular songwriter was by how many pieces of sheet music the song sold.
And the only way that sheet music was valuable to you was if you played an instrument, which the piano and the guitar and the banjo were all popular instruments. So Henry Clay Work wrote two songs that sold a million copies of the sheet music. So that made him a pretty amazing songwriter. And this was one of them. My grandfather's clock was too tall for the shelf, so it stood 90 years on the floor. It was taller by half than the old man himself, though it weighed not a penny weight more. It was bought on the morn of the day that he was born. It was always his treasure and pride, but it stopped short, never to go again when the old man died. 90 years without slumbering, tick tock, tick tock. His life seconds numbering, tick tock, tick. It stopped short, never to go again when the old man died. That song not only sold a million copies of sheet music, but it also resulted in the name of a clock, because prior to that song, a long case clock that stood on the floor was called a long case clock. It was only after Henry Clay Work wrote My Grandfather's Clock that we started calling them grandfather clocks, and we still call them that today. So the second song that he wrote, I'm going to start at the end and work my way backwards. In 1948 or 9, there was a guy running for mayor of Boston. And he was pretty far left, probably. I don't know if he was running on the socialist ticket or if everybody just said, that guy must be a socialist. But he was pretty far left. And so the radio stations didn't want to sell him advertising. So he hired a bunch of folk singers to write songs for him, put speakers on a station wagon, and had them drive around Boston playing these songs. And this one, I'm sure you're going to know it. Feel free to sing along on the chorus. Let me tell you a story of a man named Charlie on a tragic and fateful day. He put 10 cents in his pocket, kissed his wife and family, went to ride on the MTA. And did he ever return? No, he never returned. And his fate is still unlearned. He may ride forever neath the streets of Boston. He's a man who never returned. Charlie handed in his dime at the Scully Square station, and he changed for Jamaica Plain. When he got there, the conductor cried, it's one more nickel. Charlie couldn't get off of that train. And did he ever return? No, he never returned. And his fate is still unlearned. He may ride forever neath the streets of Boston. He's a man never return. So all night long, Charlie rides through the tunnel crying, what will become of me? How can I afford to see my sister in Chelsea or my cousin in Roxbury? And did he ever return? No, he never returned. And his fate is still unlearned. He may ride forever neath the streets of Boston. He's a man who never returned. Charlie's wife comes down to the Scully Square station every day at a quarter past two. And through the open window she hands Charlie a sandwich as the train goes rumbling through. And did he ever return? No, he never returned. And his fate is still unlearned. He may ride forever neath the streets of Boston. He's a man who never returned. ye citizens of Boston, don't you think it's a scandal the way we have to pay and pay? Fight the fare increase, vote for Walter O'Brien, help get Charlie off of the MTA. And did he ever return? No, he never returned, and his fate is still unlearned. He may ride forever neath the streets of Boston. He's a man who never returned. He's a man who never returned. You know, it's interesting. I mean, his wife gives him a sandwich every day. I mean, she really didn't want him to come home, I don't think. And then the other thing that's interesting, though, if you go to Boston today and you get a fare card, you know, just like the Venter card we have here in Boston, it's called the Charlie card. So it's this is something where, you know, art imitates life, life imitates art. So that was in 1949. If you go back about almost 50 years, shortly after the turn of the century, there's another song that's sort of related to that. And my middle daughter, Emily, and I went to Roanoke, Virginia. We have some friends there, and they were involved in running an excursion train from Roanoke to Danville. And so we went to help them out, you know, got on the train, we're car hosts, pointing out all the interesting sights along the way. You go east from Roanoke on the Norfolk and Western Railway to Lynchburg, and then you make a right, and you go south on the Southern Railway to Danville. And when you get to Danville, you go across the Dan River on this beautiful high bridge where you can see literally for miles in both directions. But if you look out to the right as you're going across the bridge on the way south, you can see where Stillhouse Trestle was. And Stillhouse Trestle was sort of exactly how you don't want to build something. It was a failure of engineering because the old entry into Danville, the Southern, came down a very steep hill, and this trestle was on a sharp curve, and then there was another curve to go across the river, and so you really had to have control of the train. And unfortunately, Steve Brody, who was the engineer on this particular day on this particular train, did not have control over it. So on a cold, frosty morning in the month of September, and the clouds were a-hanging low, number 97 left the Washington station like an arrow shot from a bow. Well, they gave him his orders down in Monroe, Virginia, saying, Steve, you're way behind time. This is not 38, but it's old 97. You must put her in to Spencer on time. So he turned and said to his black, greasy fireman, won't you shovel on a little more coal? And when we cross that white oak mountain, you can watch old 97 roll. It's a mighty rough road from Lynchburg to Danville on a line on a 3-mile grade. It was on that grade that he lost his average. You can see what a jump he made. He was going down the track doing 90 miles an hour when his whistle broke into a scream. And they found him in the wreck, his hand on the throttle, he was scalded to death by the steam. So the message did come to the Monroe station, and this is how it read. Brave engineer that drove old 97 is lying down in Danville dead. So gather round, you ladies, listen to my story, there is something that you might learn. Never speak harsh words to your true loving husband, may leave you, never return. Thank you. So Emily and I, when we got to Danville, got off the train, we noticed that the town was having a real party. It was summer festival, and we walked around a little bit, and there was a bluegrass band playing, and they were pretty good. And we're listening to them, and they took a break, and Emily went up to them and said, "You know, you guys should play Wreck of the Old 97." And they're like, "What?" Like, "Well, you're in Danville. You should play Wreck of the Old 97." They said, they had never heard of it. It was a bluegrass band from Western North Carolina, first time they'd played in Danville. So, you know, she's explaining the same story to him about the train and everything. And the guy goes, "Lady, do you know the song?" She says, "Yeah, my dad and I know this song." So we ended up singing it for him. And we ended up singing it with them after they got back from the break. And a couple months later, they sent me a recording. They actually recorded the song. So, you know, you can have influence on people every now and then. So that song sounded kind of similar to MTA, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so now we're going to go back to the mid-19th century. And this is the song that Henry Clay Work wrote. A summer's day, when the wave was rippled on the softest, gentlest breeze, did a ship set sail with cargo laden for a port across the seas. There were sweet farewells, loving signals, while a form was yet discerned. Though they knew it not, 'twas a solemn parting, for the ship never returned. Did she ever return? She never returned. Things yet unlearned. Though they knew it not, 'twas a solemn part. The ship, she never returned. Said a feeble lad to his anxious mother, "I must cross the wide, wide sea. There's a chance in a foreign climate. There is health and strength for me. A gleam of hope in a maze of danger, and her heart for her youngest yearned. Yet she sent him forth with hope and pleasure on the ship that never returned. And did she ever return? She never returned. Her fate is still unlearned. The part of part of the part of the ship, she never returned. The ship, she never returned." Million copies of that, MTA, Wreck of the Old 97, probably 20 other songs, all from the work of Henry Clay Work from the 1850s. And you don't know when you listen to MTA where the music came from. You don't know when you listen to Wreck of the Old 97. This is somebody who's been forgotten, but his music was going to live on for a long, long time. So, I've explained to you how much I like the Illinois Central, and I went to work there in 1973. When I got out of high school, I went down to the superintendent's office, and I said, "I'm going to college, and I'm going to learn about railroads, and I want to be a switchman." And he said, "Son, you couldn't switch a carload of horse manure out of a trainload of bananas." And I didn't realize I'd been insulted. I thought this was like a problem-solving exercise, and if I could demonstrate to him that I knew how to do that, he didn't really want any college kids. So I wrote to the president of the Illinois Central Railroad, Alan Boyd, and said, "You know, I read the speech that you made about how you need to get young people involved in the railroad industry back in 73. I fit that description. And so a couple days later, got a phone call, and this guy said, "Hi, you know, with the Illinois Central Railroad, do you have some time to meet with me?" And I went over, and it was a guy from Chicago who was in the personnel department, and he said, "So I understand you want to have a job with the railroad." And I said, "Yeah." He said, "What do you want to do?" I said, "I just want to be a switchman." He goes, "You're a switchman." I started the next day. And so one of the things about the railroad is that it's a very family-oriented thing, and so there were lots of people who were related to each other, but I wasn't related to anybody. So, you know, people would say to me, "Ellis, not any Ellises here. There's a bunch of Lampleys, and there's Johnsons, and there's wild woods, but there's not any Ellis's. Who are you related to? And I said, I'm not related to anybody. Well, how'd you get the job? I wrote to the president. Oh, well, that can be your nickname then. We'll just call you the president. Tell the president to go couple up all the cars in track six. Tell the president to take the engines over to get fuel. You know, so they thought that was very funny. But at the end, I was a president of a railroad, and so I had the last laugh on them. But I got into it because I liked riding the train. And I really liked riding the trains on the Illinois Central because they were fast. And they were so fast that the town of Magnolia, Mississippi has a sign that says cleanest town in the USA. And that's because the city of New Orleans went through there twice a day at 100 miles an hour and sucked all the trash out of town. So I mentioned earlier, Carlos Collier was the train master in Fulton that fired Roy Stewart. Well, Carlos got in trouble for something else, and he got fired. And in his case, because he was in management and he got fired, he got to go back to being an engineer. So I worked with him a few times in the yard, and interesting character. He started in the 50s when the whole railroad was still steam engines in Kentucky. And he worked on jobs that went into coal mines and pulled out loaded coal cars and took empty coal cars in. Never got over 10 miles an hour. It was hot, dusty work. They shoveled 12 to 15 tons of coal every day into the firebox. It was just backbreaking work, and it was a 16-hour work limit at that point. So imagine shoveling coal for 16 straight hours, pretty hard. So they put a notice up on the bulletin board that they wanted men in Champaign, Illinois, and he thought, you know, I just need a change of scenery. So he borrowed out up to Champaign, and the very first train that he got leaving Champaign was train number one, the city of New Orleans. He'd never even been on a diesel locomotive before. And so he's sitting there reading the timetable, trying to learn something about the road, and the old engineer, you know, grizzled old guy, big long beard, looks over at him and says, you ever run one of these, Sonny? And he goes, I can run her, Dad. So he gets over, they swap seats, he gets over in the engineer's seat, and the speedometer needle's up around 115, 116 miles an hour. The maximum speed on those locomotives was 117, and it was right there. And he reaches up to notch her back, and he goes, holy crap. And the engineer goes, son, you're 2 minutes behind schedule now. Got a real bad curve coming up, though. Better slow her down. How bad is it? 90 miles an hour. So he got a real education pretty quick. And that really was the city of New Orleans. I have to tell you that I was pretty darn resentful when Steve Goodman came out with the song, City of New Orleans, because that was my train. You know, I knew all about that train because I had ridden that train many times. But I've come to love the song. And, in fact, in the last 10 or 12 years, I had a music venue at the top of a mountain in Colorado that you could only get to by train. And we actually bought the club car from the city of New Orleans that Stevie Goodman wrote the song in. And we would go from Alamosa, Colorado, up to Fur at 9,000 feet. Definitely don't want to go there with oxygen. Or actually, a lot of people did go there with oxygen. And it was a lot of fun because people would get on the train and they would go, this is the real club car. Yeah, this is a real club car. Well, where did Stevie sit? I don't know. I wasn't there. But everybody really kind of got to the vibe. And so I wrote an additional verse to City of New Orleans. You guys are welcome to sing along with the song, with the chorus, anything you want to. You can hum along with it if you don't know the words. And I'm gonna close with this. And I really hope you enjoyed being here as much as I did, because I've just had a blast playing for you. Riding on the city of New Orleans, Illinois Central, Monday morning rail. 15 cars, 15 restless riders, 3 conductors, and 25 sacks of mail. Out on the southbound Odyssey, the train pulls out of Kankakee, rolls along past houses, farms, and fields.
passing town have no name in freight yards full of old black men, graveyards, rusted automobiles, singing good morning America, how are you, saying don't you know me, I'm your native son, I'm the train they call City of New Orleans. I'll be gone 500 miles when the day is done. Well, I was dealing cards with old John back there in the club car. Penny a point, no one keeping score. Pass a paper bag that holds a bottle. Feel the wheels grumbling through the floor. And the sons of Pullman porters, sons of engineers, ride their father's magic carpet made of steam. The mothers with their babes asleep, rocking to the gentle beat, rhythm of the rails, all they dream. Singing good morning America, how are you? Saying, don't you know me, I'm your native son. I'm the train they call the City of New Orleans. And I'll be gone 500 miles when the day is done. Well, it's nighttime on the City of New Orleans. Changing cars in Memphis, Tennessee. It must be real late. Halfway home, we'll be there by morning. Through the Mississippi darkness, rolling down to the sea. All the towns and people seem to fade into a bad dream, and the steel rails still ain't heard the news. The conductor sings his songs again, its passengers will please refrain. This train got to disappear in railroad blues. Singing good night, America. How are you? Saying, don't you know me? I'm your native son. I'm the train you call City of New Orleans. And I'll be gone 500 miles when the day is done. This is my verse. Nowadays on the City of New Orleans, you may find yourself traveling different tracks. The coaches, club cars, diners all have scattered. I don't think they're ever going back. But the cars are warm and comfortable. Seldom are they really full. Rolling across Colorado range. As friends share stories, food and song, this train of memories rolls along. World will wait while we're riding on this train. Singing good morning, America, how are you? Saying, don't you know me? I'm your native son. I'm the train they call City of New Orleans. I'll be gone 500 miles when the day is done. Thank you.
You know, I tell these people every week, Ed, nobody gets out of the coffee house without an encore. And there he was trying to run like a sissy. But next week, Sam Robbins on this stage, 8 o'clock. Tomorrow, Maple Street Chapel, 7 o'clock. But, Ed, just by chance, would you have one more song?
I might have one
more. Oh, good. Well, take it away then.
Okay. This was, Woody Guthrie said this was his favorite song. You're welcome to sing along on this, too. Go to sleep, you weary hobo. Let the towns drift slowly by. Can't you hear the steel rails humming?
lullaby. Don't you worry about tomorrow. Let tomorrow come and go. Tonight you're in a nice warm boxcar, safe from all the wind and snow. So go to sleep, weary hobo. Let the towns drift slowly by. Can't you hear the steel rails humming? That's the hobo's lullaby. I know your clothes are torn and tattered, and your hair is turning gray. But smile, don't think about your troubles. You'll find happiness someday. So go to sleep, you weary hobo. Let the towns drift slowly by. Can't you hear the steel rails humming? That's the hobo's lullaby. Well, I know the police cause you trouble. They cause trouble everywhere. But when you die and go to heaven, you'll find no policeman there. So go to sleep, you weary hobo. Let the towns drift slowly by. Can't you hear the steel rails humming? That's the hobo's lullaby. That's the hobo's lullaby. Thank you very much. Thanks for coming out for live music. I hope you come back again next week.
Save New Orleans.